Musicians are a special group of patients. Like policemen, emergency room physicians, or interpreters, musicians depend on an acute sense of hearing for their job. But due to the nature of their profession, they are at increased risk for exposure to damaging levels of sound and the resultant hearing loss. Where do musicians work? What type of differences are there among them? And what are some basic categories and definitions we can look at? Musicians are a diverse group of people playing different types of instruments in different settings. Some instruments are amplified, while others are not. Some instruments are quite close to the ear and produce a lot of SPL directly from the instrument. Other types of instruments, such as electronic instruments or electronic keyboards, may not produce any sound on their own, but rather send the sound to a speaker that may be at any given distance from the player. Some musicians play as a hobby, some semi-professionally, and some professionally. These likely involve different amounts of practice and playing time, which will affect their overall noise exposure. Another group of people to consider who may come to see an audiologist for hearing protection are concert goers. These patients do not play an instrument themselves, but can be subjected to damaging sound levels at concerts and shows. As we go through information related to musicians, we can apply some of the same information to concert goers. Let's look at a few definitions and categories of types of musicians you might see in your clinic. First, rock and pop musicians. These tend to play the popular instruments that you are familiar with, such as guitar, drums, bass, and singing vocals. These types of musicians tend to use amplified instruments or sound systems. As an audiologist, you'll need to know the instrument played and the position of the players with respect to other instruments and the amplification system or speakers surrounding them. You'll also need to know how many hours a day or a week they play. Remember that both practice and performance count towards their total exposure. One paper showed that an average dBA level for a small rock venue to be around 110 dBA. OSHA says that this would cause hearing loss or that a person would receive their daily dose of noise in 30 minutes. According to NIOSH standards, this person would have a full noise dose in a matter of just a few minutes. I myself have personally measured rock performances in various venues over the years at anywhere between 98 dBA to an ear-splitting 115 dBA. Classical musicians may be exposed to less overall sound and less damaging sound, although placement within the orchestra is key, as is the instrument. Orchestra players are well known to suffer from hearing loss, and certain instruments are louder than others. Trumpets and trombones produce extremely intense SPL and are among the loudest instruments in the genre. Violins can also produce high SPL at the closer ear, and asymmetrical loss in violinists is not uncommon. It's important to know the instrument played, how often the musician plays, and the position of the player within the orchestra when evaluating these patients. When trying to calculate total exposure time, remember both practice and performance, as classical musicians often spend a lot of hours in practice to maintain top-level skills and may also teach lessons as well. Classical music and classical instruments in concert tend to range between 80 and 100 dBA. A grand piano, for reference, often plays in the 85 to 90 dBA range, so you can use that as a gauge for comparison to other instruments. Jazz musicians tend to fall somewhere between classical and rock or pop musicians. Often small jazz venues do not amplify the instruments but rely on natural transmission of sound. This can be quite intense in the case of trumpets and other horns and drums. Larger venues may use sound systems or amplification. Jazz music does depend more on dynamics and often alternates between softer and louder sections, which would reduce overall exposure due to these softer sections. Thinking about hearing protection for these patients is about individual factors. What's the instrument? Is it a jazz drummer, jazz pianist, or jazz trombonist, for example? As mentioned before, some of these instruments are louder than others. At a musician's outreach event, I once took a sound level measurement had a jazz drum professor's kit at his ear level while he was playing his drum set in his natural style. That reading ranged between 100 and 105 dBA. The last category would be those who are in the audience, including concert goers and also soundboard operators. Concert goers would be exposed to the same dB level that we've been talking about previously for these different types of shows. Soundboard operators are technicians who mix and feed the sound from the musicians' instruments on stage into the house sound system, where they balance it for the audience and for themselves. They would be exposed to the same levels of sound as concert goers. There are many different products on the market for musicians and concert goers, and the selection is growing. Society is slowly becoming more and more aware of the negative consequences of hearing loss and the risk for damage at loud events. Some of that awareness is filtering down into the performing arts. Now more than ever, more musicians and concert goers are aware of the importance of protecting hearing. Despite the excellent progress, audiologists will need to continue to educate the public in this area for many years to come. Because the range of products available is growing, let's take a second to look at a few categories of different types of plugs that are available on the market. The main categories we consider are foam earplugs, stock or generic fit filtered earplugs, and custom molded filtered earplugs. Let's take a general look at each category and then get to more specifics as we go. First, foam earplugs. These are the typical yellow plugs that almost everyone is familiar with. They are extremely inexpensive and can be found at every pharmacy or drugstore. They are sometimes sold at music venues for people who arrive without earplugs and realize that the sound is too loud for them. The attenuation of these plugs is very high if they are properly inserted, and noise reduction ratings can be upwards of 28 to 30 plus decibels. However, with these plugs, the treble range is much more attenuated than the bass. Here's an attenuation graph for a popular type of foam earplug. As you can see, the attenuation starts off above 35 decibels in the very lowest of frequencies and continues to get essentially higher and higher as the frequency increases. It's important to know that different instruments occupy different frequency ranges in terms of the sound they produce. For example, a bass guitar or bass drum will produce a sound that's more along the very low frequency part of this graph. Instruments like piano and guitar will operate in the mid-range of this graph and receive a different attenuation from those of the bass. Therefore, someone who's listening to a song would hear the bass drum and the bass guitar better than they would hear any piano or guitar. More high-frequency instruments like bells, chimes, or flute notes will be above this range and will get even more reduction. The overall result is that the frequency response will be changed from its natural presentation, and the overall impression will be that the music sounds muddy, muffled, or not crisp because the treble range is being attenuated more highly than the bass range. Most musicians and concertgoers find this an unacceptable alteration of the quality of music and often prefer to not use these foam plugs. Their upsides, however, are low cost, high availability, and ability to conform to most ear canal shapes and sizes. Next, stock or generic fit filtered earplugs. This is a group of earplugs that attempts to improve the listening experience by attenuating frequencies more evenly, creating a more balanced sound. There's a lot of variation in the different designs and different products that are available. Accordingly, there's a lot of variation in how flatly or evenly they attenuate the sound. Here are a few examples of different attenuation graphs from different products.
Here's a graph that compares attenuation for fully inserted foam earplugs against a shallow insertion for those same foam earplugs, and then against a stock fit filtered earplug. The fully inserted foam plug shows the heavy attenuation we noted before, with the highs more attenuated, losing the crispness of sound. That is compared against a shallowly inserted foam earplug, which is a workaround some people use to adjust the attenuation when they are displeased with the sound of the full attenuation. But the highs are still more attenuated than the lows. Pictured above is the Edimotic ER20XS. The attenuation, although not totally flat, is much flatter across the frequency range, delivering a more balanced sound for the listener. Here is one that takes a different approach. This is the Eraser by Persona Medical. These plugs attenuate upper mid-range the most, with the goal being to take out the perceived harshness which can occur around this frequency area. With an NRR of 5, the overall reduction is quite low. This gives a musician or concert goer an overall feeling that the sound is still loud, which people tend to enjoy. The cost of the devices range from around $12 to around $60, and they are typically available in music stores and online. The upsides here are relatively low cost to obtain and superior sound compared to foam plugs. The biggest downside is the non-custom and non-conforming nature of these plugs. They may come in different sizes, but a comfortable and stable fit in the ear is not always possible, especially for ear canals that are smaller or more extreme in the angle of the first bend. Finally, custom molded filtered earplugs, also commonly referred to as musician's earplugs. These are earplugs made from an ear mold impression done by an audiologist. The resulting ear mold is built to accommodate an interchangeable acoustic filter inserted into it, which lowers the overall volume of the music without distorting the clarity and balance, i.e., the attenuation is very flat or even. Their main upsides are superior sound quality and wearing comfort for any shape of ear canal. The downsides are cost and increased time and effort to acquire. They are typically available only through an audiologist, and the cost varies anywhere from around $140 to $220. Let's go over a bit of history to understand how we got to where we are now, and how that affects the choices we have. Originally, the specialized filter for musicians' earplugs was created and manufactured by a company called Edimotic Research. These are the Edimotic filters. They sell these filters to ear mold companies who create ear molds that are designed to accept the filters. The ear mold company then inserts the Edimotic filters inside. This is shipped to the audiologist to give to the patient. This is the way it was for decades. More recently, there has been a demand for competing filters of the same size and type as the Edimotic filters, and also smaller filters that could be used to create a smaller, more cosmetically appealing ear mold. Some ear mold companies have now switched to these other filter manufacturing companies, such as one called Dynamic Ear, which makes these smaller filters. Order a musician's earplug from a company that uses these filters, such as Starkey, and you will get the smaller filter with different attenuation characteristics than that of the traditional Edimotic filters. Let's look at some different attenuation graphs for the different styles of filters. First, the classic Edimotic filters. There is the 9 dB filter, the 15 dB filter, and the 25 dB filter. Next, there is a filter designed by an ear mold company called Microsonic, which is called the Pulse or the pulse filter. It's meant to mimic the atomotic filter in both size and function, and the company states they're interchangeable with atomotic filters. These are offered in 10 dB, 15 dB, 25 dB, and 30 dB attenuations. Finally, the newer, smaller filters by Dynamic Ear. These come in different attenuations that are color-coded and specified by both the American noise reduction rating and the European standard, which are both different ways of quantifying overall hearing protection. As mentioned before, these are being placed into custom ear molds to make smaller musicians' plugs. It's also worth noting that many stock filtered or universal fit earplugs are also using these filters, such as the Westone True Universal Fit plugs and many other companies which are inserting these dynamic ear filters into different stock fit designs. Here is a picture that shows the different average attenuations for each of these filters. Notice that the noise reduction rating is much lower than the stated average attenuation. We'll return to this later for a short discussion of why these are different and how to use these numbers to choose the right protection for your patients based on their noise exposure. Here's a graph from Westone showing the different attenuation curves for these filters. You can notice that some curves are indeed flatter than others. We want to be aware of these attenuation properties when choosing filters for our patients. For example, the 10 dB filter has more attenuation in the highs than the bass. Does this match your patient's instrument or their desired attenuation needs for the type of music they are listening to, or a desire for the most transparent attenuation? All things to consider when choosing a plug for your patient. A full discussion about attenuation standards and methods is out of the scope of this video. However, here's a quick, clinically focused guide for how to use the different attenuation values for your patients. First, we'll notice that there are three main ways that people talk about attenuation: the NRR, the average dB of attenuation, and the SNR. First, the NRR stands for noise reduction rating. It's a rating that the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency requires earplugs to have been tested for and to display on the packaging. The NRR does not equate directly to dB of reduction of a sound. It has correction factors that account for variability in testing, individual ear canal variability in attenuation, and a correction factor for improper insertion. You should see the NRR listed on any hearing protection device in America. Next, average dB of attenuation. This is a simple average of attenuation in dB SPL across all frequencies of test, typically measured at the eardrum. This is what musicians' filter companies use in their marketing and naming of their filters, as we saw earlier with the small dynamic ear filters and the microsonic pulse filters. Remember that if a filter has a 10 dB attenuation name or rating, it doesn't mean that the attenuation is flat at all frequencies, as we've seen earlier. Finally, SNR, which stands for single number rating. This is based on the European standard and is their version of NRR. This is very much like the average dB of attenuation numbers that we just described that manufacturers use. It's a simple measurement of attenuation of dB at the eardrum across frequencies. So, which should I use for my patient when calculating the amount of attenuation needed? This is actually a bit of a complex question involving several different factors, such as the understanding and dexterity needed to complete proper insertion, and the conformity of the plug or ear mold to the shape of the ear canal. Round, straight ear canals will achieve a better fit more easily and hence more likely to achieve the stated reduction than curved, elliptical-shaped, or otherwise tortuously shaped ear canals. Here's a short guide you can use for clinical interactions. First, for custom molded products that are molded to the ear canal and all but ensure a proper insertion and attenuation, the average attenuation numbers from the manufacturer can be used. 2. For stock or generic fit earplugs, the situation is a bit more complex. If you can assess the fit and it appears good, you can use the average attenuation numbers quoted by the manufacturer. If the fit is not good, you're not able to assess it, or there are insertion problems, it's best to assume that the reduction is anywhere from 25 to 70% less than quoted. If you have any doubts, you can always perform real ear measurements on the patient with the plugs in, or test hearing in the sound field with and without plugs to determine the actual attenuation from this stock or generic fit plug. Now let's meet a real musician who is looking for a new pair of musician's earplugs. We'll be meeting Miss Rebekah Daley, who is the principal French horn player for the North Carolina Symphony Orchestra. In the following section, we'll hear directly from her what her needs are, what types and how much noise she's exposed to, how she uses or doesn't use hearing protection, and her reactions and perceptions of hearing protection. We'll also see the information you've learned so far in this video applied to a real clinical situation. For this patient interaction, we'll be entering the UNC Hearing and Communication Center, the audiology faculty practice of the UNC School of Medicine's Division of Speech and Hearing Sciences.
Rebekah Daley,
okay. And so you're a professional musician?
Yes, I am the principal horn of the North Carolina Symphony.
Awesome. How long have you been doing that?
I have been with the North Carolina Symphony for about 8 years, and I've been playing for over 20.
And then how did you get interested in the French horn? What was it?
I was always going to play an instrument. Mm-hmm. I started playing piano when I was really young, at 4, and was really enthusiastic about it, but also it came quite naturally. I come from a really musical family. And my sister played the flute. And anyone who knows anything about band, there's a ton of flute players and not very many French horn players. Initially I was thinking about the trumpet, but I thought that with the French horn, I could beat my sister at all of these honor bands we were applying for without working very hard. And my plot worked. I've always loved music. The choice of the instrument was a little bit vindictive, but then I really grew to love the sound of the horn. I think everyone, without even knowing it, knows what a French horn sounds like. It's in every single movie, and some really famous themes are played by the horn. It's really prominent in Star Wars, and where I grew up was, we didn't have access to orchestras, so that sort of sound developed from movies, and knew that was it for me. That had to be my profession. So yeah, that's all that.
So what can you describe the sound of the French horn?
It's really vocal. It should sound a lot like the voice. It can be really mellow, kind of like a cello, but it can also have that edge and that cutting sound of another brass instrument like a trumpet. It's incredibly resonant, lots of high overtones, lots of low overtones, lots of resonance, like lots of core. It kind of has, I think it has everything all in one. You can play as high some of the notes that you play are the same notes that a piccolo plays, and a lot of the low notes you play are as low as what a tuba plays. You know, you can't go as low as a tuba, but it's a large range. It's vocal.
What parts, I'm trying to think about Star Wars, what parts of Star Wars have French horn? Are there any famous sections that have French horn?
Da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. All of those themes are often, well, those are all brass, but then there's a lot of da-da-da-da-da-da-da. Oftentimes those are played by horn. Very often Princess Leia's theme is played by a horn. That's actually the solo I have played more than any other in my professional career. Is Princess Leia's theme, so.
Nice. So when you are listening, when you're playing your own horn, tell me what you listen for with your own ears, and then tell me, you know, how that changes a bit when you put your musician's plugs in.
These are Rebekah's earplugs, the ones that she's been wearing for some years now. Take a look at the canal length of these custom molded plugs. Also note that these are using the dynamic ear filters. The officially stated SNR value, as these are a European product, is 17, which would mean 17 dB of average attenuation. Looking at the chart, you can see a bit more detailed view of how much attenuation Rebekah is getting, and therefore know a bit about what she's experiencing when she describes her answer to how things sound with the earplugs in.
I don't practice with musician plugs. When I'm practicing at home, I'm listening for, I want a quality sound. Playing with plugs can be really challenging. We have to protect our ears in certain circumstances. It's much harder to play with people around you when you're wearing plugs. So, you have to find a way to balance protecting your ears and still getting the job done.
What is it that makes it harder with playing with people around you with plugs?
So, do you mean musician plugs or like just normal plugs?
Tell me the difference. Tell me how they're different.
Okay.
I mean, for you when you're playing.
Yeah. So in most orchestras backstage, they're going to have just normal earplugs, like what you might wear if you're at a concert or mowing the lawn or whatever. And when you put these plugs in, your sound is incredibly distorted. So all of a sudden, I'm not hearing how I really sound. And the other part about it that's really disconcerting is I get all of those internal sounds. I'm doing some weird stuff, right? I'm going, and the sounds that are happening inside your mouth while you're doing that, you end up getting a lot more internal sound actually than what's happening outside of you. So that's why we need musician plugs, which filter out the sound, but allow more integrity of the sound. Mm-hmm. You need it so that you can still hear intonation. You still need to hear people because you still need to play with them. So you want to filter, not totally dampen.
Totally dampen. And when you practice at home for a practice session, how long might it be that you're actually playing per day?
Yeah, so there's three components. There's all of the work that you have to do in order to go into work, because in a professional orchestra, when you go in, the expectation is that you already know how the music goes, you already know exactly where you're gonna play, your part is learned, and everything just needs to come together. So that involves quite a bit of work at home in personal practice. In addition to that, there's certain fundamentals that people have to do to keep their playing in shape. And so then you have the rehearsals at work, and then you have the concerts.
Yeah. So if you were out of all the hours that you're playing in a whole week, let's say, when, you know, not during this crisis, but normal times, mm-hmm. all the hours that you play during a week and you added them all up, what would it be?
Oh, wow. Okay. 7, 8, 9. Probably an average of like 8 or 9 hours of personal practice. For me personally, all instruments are different. All positions are different. But for a principal horn player, or for me personally, probably about 9 hours, 9 or 10 personal practice. And then, you know, 8, maybe like 10 hours of rehearsals, and then 3 concerts at 2.5 hours each.
Yeah, gotcha. Gotcha. So you're around 25, 26, yeah, somewhere like that.
Plus all the hours I spend teaching, which is usually maybe seven hours a week.
Quite a lot. Do your ears ever ring, or do you have muffled hearing after a long practice session without plugs, or a long concert, or a loud concert without plugs, or, you know, if you forget them one day or something? Do you ever feel something going funny with your ears?
Yes. The worst ones I actually remember very specifically. Sometimes if you don't know how a piece goes, you might not know that there is going to be you don't know exactly what to anticipate behind you in the percussion section. So usually the first time you're going through a piece, or the first few times, you don't know what's coming. So it's happened a few times, more than a few times, where something really loud will happen right behind you, because I sit right in front of the percussion. So if you sit in front of the trumpets, you've got a different thing to deal with if you sit in front of whoever you're sitting near. But for me personally, I'm often right in front of the percussion. So an extra vigorous bass drum, I've had muffled and ringing after that. Various bells, if it hits just the right kind of timbre, it feels funny. So usually in our music, actually what we have is, before a really loud section, you write plugs, and then you mark it into your music where you need to put the plugs in. But in order to find that out, that involves going through it once or twice without the plugs, usually. And then another thing that's actually becoming much more prevalent and becoming a bigger hearing issue in orchestras is we are doing more and more of these concerts with other acts, whether it's a band or Leanne Rimes or a Prince impersonator or something like that. And that involves usually a band at the front of the stage in addition to the orchestra, and they're all amplified. So actually the single biggest offender as far as the hearing issues that I experience at work is probably those amplified concerts.
Is there anything that you, what do you like and not like about your plugs?
They took me a while to figure out how to get in my ears. And even now, sometimes if I have to get them in really quickly, they can be challenging to get in quickly. I like that I can get a decent feel for how I sound with them in, but I wish they did a better job, actually. So it's better than run-of-the-mill foam earplugs, but I would like to think that there is possibly even a better option, because how it feels and how you sound when you are playing is an incredibly important part of the, to me, that's actually probably the biggest factor in my choice in earplugs.
What do these do to the sound? Tell me a little bit more about that. What is it about the sound that makes it a good sound for you? Obviously, natural is the best. Mm-hmm. The foam plugs are the worst, and these are in the middle. Mm-hmm. What makes these a little better than the foam plugs, but not as good as natural?
These are better than foam because I'm not getting all of the sound from inside. I'm not getting all the internal noises.
Internal noises.
That's the biggest thing that this helps with. And I also get a much more accurate sound of my playing. The sound, and the sound of everyone around me, actually, is better. The thing that's really interesting with these is I feel that I get a lot more of my own sound and less of the people around me. So I can still hear myself, but I have a much harder time telling if I'm in tune with someone else. And that's the part that's a problem.
Rebekah has identified a problem with her current plugs. She can hear herself well, but appears to not be able to hear others as well. This is most likely a result of the amount of the reduction. It appears to be too much attenuation to hear others well, as they are further away and the sound is less intense by the time it reaches her, especially for soft passages, we would assume. Rebekah has also told us that she takes her earplugs in and out during a performance. This also suggests that the reduction is too much to allow her to play comfortably in this work situation with her fellow instrument players.
So there's a lot of compression, and that can create strange, like, kind of noises. And sometimes you hear a lot of those with the foam earplugs on, even if you don't hear it externally.
Here, Rebekah is referring to the occlusion effect, which can be worse with foam earplugs as the insertion is not very deep. This is one reason why musicians' earplugs are made to go to or past the second bend.
But so you get, oh, that's just magnified, and that is deeply unpleasant. And you hear your tongue. If you're playing and you're, all of those tongue motions you hear. So that's, yeah, that's, those are the weird internal noises.
Those?
Yes, that's really important because sometimes I have to get them in really quickly. So if I have to, not everyone has the cord. I know some people who just set them on their music stand and then put them in one at a time. I am forever dropping things. So the cord for me is really important. And if I'm going to use them, I'll put my hair up usually so that I can find them in my hair. And I'll have them wrapped around with, and also then I can quickly identify which is which side. Because if they're just sitting there, I mean, that's going to take me a lot more time to, okay, red is right. And also I don't like to have to be reaching for things while I'm holding my instrument. Because again, I'm clumsy and I might drop it. Which, then you've got bigger problems. So.
Part of best practice for taking care of musicians' hearing from a comprehensive perspective is to test their hearing thoroughly, so as to have a baseline to monitor for changes and to assess whether or not the protection habits they've been using so far have been sufficient to protect hearing. I recommend three major assessments. First, an audiogram with all interoctaves. Testing at 3K and 6K particularly are critical for seeing any noise notches that may be present or developing. 2. Otoacoustic emissions. These reflect outer hair cell function, which are the first to be damaged from noise exposure. Otoacoustic emissions can detect very mild hearing damage that may have already happened and serve as a more sensitive monitoring data set in the case of future testing. 3. High-frequency audiometry. Although this type of testing is not normed, it may serve as a potential data set for monitoring changes intrapersonally. Let's take a look at the objective data and results from testing. First, the audiogram. What you can see here is that Rebekah has normal hearing in both ears across the frequency range, and testing at interoctaves, especially 3K and 6K, allows us to see that there is no noise notch either present nor appears to be developing. Next, otoacoustic emissions. If you were to look at Rebekah's audiogram, you would assume that she had been playing music for more than 25 years without sustaining any damage. However, looking at the otoacoustic emissions, we can see a deeper level of detail. Although neither ear shows a classic noise notch pattern, we can see that there is damage to the outer hair cells at different frequency ranges in both ears. As this damage is more than to be expected in a 32-year-old female with an otherwise unremarkable history, we can assume that this outer hair cell damage is due to a lifetime of noise exposure as a musician. Let's talk about ear mold impressions for musicians' earplugs. The ultimate goal here is to make a tight-fitting ear mold that is sure to maintain a seal even if the musician is opening their jaw wide during singing or otherwise moving their jaw while playing. So, an impression for these molds needs several features beyond the standard fully formed and void-free impression technique. First, make an open jaw impression with a bite block. This ensures a bigger impression in the area between the first and second bend, which helps maintain a good seal. 2. Use firm material delivered with an impression syringe.
The firm material exerts more pressure on the ear canal tissues during curing, making a bigger overall mold, which is also better for the seal. And three, have the impression go at a minimum several millimeters past the second bend. This ensures that the resulting mold is long enough to reduce the occlusion effect. These are the most important things to keep in mind. Sometimes a patient will come to you for impressions only that they will take home and send to a company themselves for the construction of a musician's plug or, more likely, in-ear monitors. In-ear monitors are custom-molded full-shell headphones for musicians to hear themselves and bandmates while playing, while simultaneously protecting their hearing. If making impressions for in-ear monitors, the same impression-making technique applies here with a few additions. 4. Use a cotton otoblock. Foam otoblocks can sometimes tear away material from the impression, degrading the impression and perhaps making it unusable. And 5. Make sure that you have a fully formed helix area. Also, a note about the impression gun. The ear mold impression gun typically uses a less firm material. It's okay to use this for a musician's plug if you have learned over time that a firm material makes a mold from any particular company that is too big or uncomfortable. I myself often use an impression gun with a bite block with my preferred company, as I have found over time that this creates a stable seal while keeping the fit comfortable. You will get a feel for this after working with different companies over time and seeing how the molds come out based on the impression material you were using. Now, let's choose a musician's earplug for Rebekah. She currently has the small dynamic ear 15 dB filters, but wants to hear more and is taking out her plugs due to this need. Based on the fact that she is in an orchestra and not a rock band, overall levels are lower and hence the need for protection is somewhat less. However, she still has amplified guest performances that cause her trouble. If Rebekah did not have plugs already, I would likely recommend a Microsonic Pulse plug with 15 dB filters to be on the conservative side for hearing protection's sake. If it was too much reduction, Rebekah could later purchase a set of 10 dB filters to have flexibility and options in the case of having a show with amplified guest performers. A chart from Etymotic also recommends as such, based on the instrument that Rebekah plays. I myself have used 15 dB filters when playing amplified guitar and with other amplified instruments in a rehearsal space with a full drum set. I found this level of reduction appropriate for this very loud environment. I can understand Rebekah's complaint that 15 dB of reduction is too much for her less loud style of music, especially for the soft passages often found in classical music. Since she already has 15 dB plugs, we will go straight to a 10 dB filter. I will use Microsonic in this case with pulse filters. The larger filters supposedly provide a more high-fidelity sound. There is no evidence to support this claim. I have personally compared Etymotic filters, which are like the pulse filters, and the smaller dynamic ear filters in equivalent reduction, both inserted into custom molds made for my ears. To my subjective opinion, the Etymotic filters had a more detailed sound and flatter attenuation. This is purely subjective, however, so no conclusions can be drawn from this. All in all, make a choice that makes sense for your patient considering cosmetic concerns and the amount of attenuation and fidelity desired. I do suggest that if your patient is in the larger filters, you may want to keep that constant. For a more cosmetically appealing solution, the smaller filters are clearly preferable. Fast forward 2 weeks and the molds are in. These are the Microsonic Pulse Musician's plugs with 10 dB filters with connector cable. you can see the mold is bigger overall to accommodate the larger filter. You can see that the ear mold goes just past the second bend. Rebekah's previous plugs are a bit longer. And here you can see how the respective filters come out. They are a simple pressure fit into the mold. The pulse filters and edemotic filters are identified with the small number that appears on the top of the filter, indicating the amount of decibel level reduction. Although hard to see, this one has a P10 standing for pulse 10. Upon removing the dynamic ear filters, these are identified by their color. They're color-coded for the amount of reduction, which you can look through the specs of the different filters to find out which color matches which reduction level. Here we have the blue filter matching the 15 dB reduction.
Oh. Yay! Okay. And then the pink is right, mm-hmm. and the blue is left.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Oh, this is so exciting. Those are very comfortable.
Oh, that's good.
Yeah. They feel like they don't go in as deep.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I kind of, this is nice. Okay.
All right.
Should I just like compare the comfort of the
sure.
two?
Sure.
Actually, can you talk a little more?
Yeah. Let's see. Right now, it's almost 4th of July. People would like to go to the beach, and they would like to go do fireworks and things like that, but they can't really do that right now. Okay, it's 4th of July. People would like to go to the beach. They'd like to do fireworks, but they can't really do that right now.
So, okay, actually, this is really interesting. So, I'm talking. I'm talking. Oh, okay. So, my own sound is much more true on these.
Mm-hmm.
The other part that's interesting is the volume kind of sounds the same when you're talking, but on these you're muffled.
Interesting.
It's like your diction goes away. So some of that clarity.
Mm-hmm.
So it might be a little bit volume, but the part that's the most interesting is that the clarity. I'm getting, like, it's really easy to understand what you're saying. Whereas these, it's a little bit like. So the difference hearing myself is not huge.
Mm.
So I'm going to be curious what the difference is
mm-hmm.
when listening to something on the outside, because that was the thing that when we talked about it, I was really hoping to see an improvement
mm-hmm.
with.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
I'm guessing that this is so loud to yourself that the difference won't be as perceivable.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The nice thing is with either one, I don't get any of that internal sound that we had talked about. The... Cool. from the pressure in your nasal cavity. So what do you want to put on?
That's totally up to you. What do you think represents a really nice, you know, a really good full range of sound, highs, lows, bass, drums, violins, everything.
Let's
and dynamics too. Dynamics, loud and soft.
Let's try Brahms. Symphony number 2. Because then what I can test is how it feels listening to it also while I'm playing.
Okay.
Okay. So I'll put these guys in first. Okay, so what's great is I can hear the orchestra a lot better with these, especially the basses. I can hear those a lot where I think that that normally gets lost. But that makes a big difference.
Mm.
I really like that.
Fantastic.
Oh, we could do a different, something very different.
Okay.
Mahler Symphony 3. That's 8 horns in unison at the beginning.
Whoa. Yeah, it's powerful.
Mm-hmm. Okay. What time is that? Easier to find the intonation. Mm-hmm. I felt I could blend my sound in with what was happening, even with the plugs in. Mm-hmm. Which is like, this feels a little bit, these plugs feel a little bit like you're playing on top of the sound. Whereas you want to play inside the sound. Or, you know, hopefully. Best case scenario. Yeah, but also even just as far as like tone and timbre,
mm-hmm.
I felt that I'm able to gauge my sound a bit better and make sure that I'm matching the tone versus with this. I felt like I don't really know what their tone is. I'm just kind of hearing pitches.
When you say hearing the tone, what do you mean exactly, the tone of the timbre?
So is it like there's all kinds of different sounds, and I like to think about timbre as you've got like the core and you've got the resonance around it. So the core is like, if a sound has more core to it and less resonance, it's going to sound brassy. Like a trumpet has a lot of core, and an instrument that has a lot of resonance and not a lot of core is a clarinet. And so that kind of sound can make things sound really drastically differently, and you have to be matching the tone as well as the intonation. It's not enough just to get one or the other. But if you can't tell what you're doing versus what you're trying to match, then you can't accomplish that at all. Let's do like Jackson 5, I Want You Back, where the levels are all very much the same.
Okay.
I just really like that song. Really interesting. It's actually really hard to tell the difference between the two because the sound quality is very different. Yeah. It sounds a lot crisper. I can't really think of a better word than crisp. It sounds a lot more crisp. So things are gonna sound a little bit louder when they're not.
Mm-hmm.
And this sounds like it rounds everything out a little bit to me. So it's, I don't know a better way to describe that. It kind of rounds it out. So it's all a little bit, it's kind of like a marshmallow over everything in a way. And there's no marshmallow. So it's hard to tell where the volume is the same because the sound is so different.
That's great. I love the marshmallow.
Don't I know anything better?
patients will often say who have hearing loss, and they put their hearing aids on. They'll say, yeah, everything sounds crisp. And then they say, oh, I take my hearing aids off, and it sounds like you put cotton over everything.
Oh, yeah.
Right? So this is that similar soft white kind of analogy.
Yes.
Yeah.
Mine just has sugar.
Okay, so now let's do this. Let's keep the volume the same.
Okay.
And then let's have you put them both in and then just, you know, just see in your estimation how different they are in terms of their overall volume.
Okay.
Yeah.
The volume seems basically the same.
Oh.
The volume seems basically the same. What I notice immediately is the difference in the crispness. So I don't notice a huge, difference in the sound actually in the volume. And it might just be that it's very, it's also a different thing like to have a speaker versus like a bass drum right behind me. I might notice a bigger difference between the two if you were to like drop something really loud behind me. But actually that's really, really interesting. What I notice mostly is the sound change. I'm sure that it does filter more with these, but what I perceive is the kind of just like the muting.
Seems about the same.
Yeah.
Nice, okay.
That is super interesting. I feel that these are gonna be, actually what I think is gonna happen is these are gonna become my sewing room earplugs. Because it'll block out more of the drum set.
Mm.
And I think that these will become my work earplugs.
Interesting.
And these might be for Pops concerts.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
This is so fascinating. This actually solves a lot of the issues that there's obviously no true comparison until I'm actually like at work.
You gotta be in there, yeah.
But I love the sound difference that I'm getting with these.
The crispness is doing something for you.
Yeah, the crispness, I think another word that I can, what I'm hearing is I'm hearing more articulation. I lose a lot of articulation with this, especially like at the very beginning of notes. I get the washed out version later, and with this I'm getting more crisp starts, which is really important if you want to play with someone. You gotta know when they're starting, so.
Nice.
Yeah.
Cool.
I'm really excited about these. Thank you so much. When I go back to work in a year, these are going to be great.
Nice.
Let's take a look at some validation results. As mentioned before, there are two ways to validate hearing protection attenuation. Real ear measurements, measuring SPL reduction at the eardrum with and without the plugs in, and sound field testing. We decided on sound field testing for validation for Rebekah's earplugs. Here's the result. The S symbol stands for sound field measurement of hearing threshold without any plugs in. These were measured in 2 decibel increments. Due to time constraints, the thresholds with plugs were measured in 5 decibel increments. The M symbol is the new plugs with 10 dB filters. The U symbol in blue represents Rebekah's previous plugs with the 15 dB filters. As you can see, the 10 dB filters and the pulse plugs delivered what looks like a flatter attenuation than the 15 dB filters, especially at 1K, 3K, and 8K. The attenuation seems to be more in line with the curvature of the sound field thresholds. This better mirroring of her sound field thresholds could account for Rebekah's perception that the 10 dB filters gave a more articulate and crisp sound. We hope you've enjoyed this video and have learned more about the details in caring for musicians' hearing and selecting and providing the best possible hearing protection for these patients. This has been a production of the UNC School of Medicine and Department of Allied Health Sciences, Division of Speech and Hearing Sciences. We would like to thank Ms. Rebekah Daley for her participation and expertise, and also thanks to the UNC Hearing and Communication Center for their clinic space and materials used to produce this video.